Let's return to The Lancet to see how dire the consequences of the nutrition transition can be for a country. This chart looks at the prevalence of obesity, defined as a body mass index over 30, among women in a variety of countries. At the bottom, you see two Pacific Island nations, Samoa and Tonga, with Tonga experiencing an astonishing obesity rate of 70%. What is happening in the South Pacific? The traditional diet among Pacific Islanders used to include exceptionally healthy complex carbs like taro root, yams, breadfruit, and bananas. These were considered by them to be the real food, and they formed the foundation of their diet. This diet was uniformly very low in fat and high in fiber-rich carbs. Their nutritious traditional foods have now taken a back seat to the worst foods of industrialized society, such as refined carbs, dairy, sweets, and fried foods. Meat, fish, and seafood were treated only as condiments once upon a time, but not anymore. Now they import fatty meats and junk carbs, displacing their traditional foods. And the price they pay for this is epidemic obesity and cardiovascular disease. You can be sure they think these saturated fat-laden animal foods taste good to them. You can also be sure these foods are ruining their health. Let's look at the other end of the chart. Ethiopia has hardly any obesity. You can be sure there are important reasons for this beyond diet preference. Ethiopia has historically had poor food security, for example. However, their traditional diet is worth a mention. Traditionally, people there ate very little in the way of animal foods, saving those for special occasions. Grains were their staple foods. The Lancet series included the observation that there is a linkage between the issue of obesity and environmental degradation. At a certain level, this should be common sense. This is not how our food is produced today. 100 years ago, our pig farms looked like this. Now they look more like this. And our poultry comes from places like this and this. This is because civilization now looks like this. The quaint family farms of our imaginations are not going to make much of a contribution to the overall food supply in the modern world. Modern appetites require that enormous numbers of animals pass through the food system. Just look at how many animals were in the U.S. alone in 2001. 10 to the 6th is 1 million. This has serious environmental costs. Industrialized livestock and fish production has put us at risk for superbugs that are resistant to antibiotics. This drug was pulled from the poultry industry once it was realized that it promoted the development of superbugs. The drug is no longer used this way, but the superbugs it created persist. We are overfishing our oceans so severely that the global collapse of our major fisheries is projected for mid-century. Agriculture is the largest user of our increasingly scarce freshwater resources. Water shortages will put our global food security at risk. The growth in livestock production required by all that future meat eating is a big problem for our water needs. Climate change will increasingly threaten the animal-sourced food sector. The awful drought this summer in Texas may have given us a glimpse into the future of cattle production. The fact is, meat production is an incredibly inefficient use of water resources. Beef is estimated here to require 86 times as much water as potatoes to produce. The wastefulness of animal-sourced foods is a hard truth that most environmentalists have not yet faced. This inherent inefficiency is very easy to understand. The conversion of food into tissue and work is energetically inefficient in all animals. Plants are far more energetically efficient than animals. More and more energy is lost as layers of animals are added to the food chain. This is why so few animals are carnivorous. The top of a very big food chain is therefore a vulnerable and unstable perch on which to sit. We'd be smart to come down from there. The extreme inefficiency of animal food production becomes clear when we calculate the number of calories that can be extracted from a given amount of land by different agricultural strategies. Oats produce more than 25 times the calories per acre as beef. Wheat is comparable to oats in its calorie yield per acre. And potatoes are way out in front of both of them. As efficient as these crops are, bananas absolutely blow them away. Notice at the bottom of this chart all the protein soybeans produce per acre. Soybeans produce twice as much protein per acre as any other crop, and up to 15 times the protein per acre as meat. These facts have such important implications for the quality of our future, and yet fad diet promoters demonize all these foods: fruit, grains, potatoes, and beans, and advocate that you eat more meat instead. These are the retrograde voices of the food world. Their heads are buried in the sand. They offer no real solutions. What about grass-fed beef, you may ask? Surely that is environmentally responsible, right? This myth will be exposed in part 3.